Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How well do you want to get to know your neighbor this morning?
Very well.
So for these kind of chapel services, we ask for your patience and love for one another if you can sit as closely as possible. We have a couple chairs on the side over here for folks coming in, a little bit more room upstairs, and there's overflow downstairs. So the board of stewards are doing an excellent job managing folks. Breathe deeply, everyone. Welcome to Highpoint University. Welcome to this Family Weekend Chapel Service. It's a delight to get to meet families, parents. I get to be with your students, your children, each week here in chapel. And so I love seeing moms and dads, grandmoms and granddads walk in. I go, oh, yeah, you look just like them. It's excellent. We're so glad you're here this morning to worship with us. A couple of announcements. Students, we continue our series on a deep dive into 1 Corinthians chapter 13. This series on love and relationships this Wednesday. It's going to be excellent. I'm going to have alongside me this week Tiffany Long John from the counseling department. So we're going to be talking about love and relationships, her from the counseling perspective, me from a pastoral perspective. This is going to be very helpful for you, very practical. I hope that you'll come and draw deeply from these waters. They're very helpful. And as always, each week, kneel afterwards. Come and meet one another, be with one another. And we're grateful for that. Families, again, we are so delighted you are here. Afterwards, I believe there is brunch. Is that right, Mrs. Tuttle? Is there brunch over in the caf? So go enjoy one another's company for brunch over in the caf. Before we begin, will you join me in a word of prayer? Gracious God, you have searched us and known us. You know our rising up and our falling down. You are ever acquainted with our ways. You knit us together in our mother's womb. For we are fearfully and wonderfully made. You delight in us and us in you. This morning we ask that you would renew us, refresh us, breathe upon us. That we might hear a word from you, a word of weight, a word of hope, a word of meaning. Words of your promise that enliven us. And make us into the people you have called us to be. So we ask not simply for your presence, we ask that we might be awake to your presence in this place. It's in your Son's name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, and welcome to our worship service. We are so glad to see all of you have joined us. This morning, our opening hymn is number 89 in your hymnbook. Would you please take those out, turn to page 89, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. I invite you to please stand and raise your voices up as we sing together.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, Lord of glory, Lord of
morning we'll be sharing together a responsorial psalm, so if you could please take out your hymnals again and turn to page 738. This is Psalm 1. I'm going to help you sing this response. So first I will demonstrate it for you, and then I'm going to invite you to sing it along with me. It's actually from an African American spiritual. And then we'll go into the reading of the psalm and call it response. So
like a tree that's planted by the water, we shall not be moved.
Go ahead and sing that with me, Ed. Otherwise, wouldn't receive Christmas gifts.
And our goal this year is to raise enough gifts and money to support 151 children and families. And we'd really like to thank you in advance for your continued support.
Please pray with me. Dear God, thank you for gathering us all here today. We're so blessed to have our moms and dads, our grandparents, siblings, and other loved ones join us on our beautiful campus on this family weekend. Please help us, God, to have open hearts and minds as we experience your presence here today. And now will you join me in reading the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our starting in verse 33. Jesus is speaking to people here, and I would also ask that you open your hearts, open your minds, that you may hear how the Spirit is speaking today. That's Matthew chapter 12, verse 33, and that's on page 12 of Jesus. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For the tree is known by its fruit. You brood of vipers, how can you speak good things when you are evil? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. The good person brings good things out of a good treasure, and the evil person brings evil things out of an evil treasure. I tell you, on the day of judgment, you will have to give an account for every careless word you utter. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. The word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jacob, for that very inspiring reading. You got to know how odd you are, how wonderfully odd you are to be here this morning. Your friends are at brunch. Some parents have already headed home, beat the traffic. And you're in Hayward Chapel at High Point University hearing, "You brood of vipers." And by your words, you will be justified or condemned. You're wonderfully odd. One of my favorite quotes I tell students is that you will know the truth, and the truth will make you odd. Something about us, these words got such weight, but there's something about something in us that desires them. Like, we want some weight in our life. Like, this is, Scripture never stops giving us more weight. Weighty lives. It starts kind of like moral readings. Like, you open Scripture, and there's things like, sell all that you have and give it to the poor. Or like, if you have two coats, give one to someone who needs it. It's just so out of character with our culture, right? It's got so much weight to it. A student actually came and saw me this week. This was great. He was having a tough time. He's like, "I don't know how to read Scripture. Can you point me to what to read?" I'm like, "Well, don't go read this week." Like, we have a kind of presupposition of approaching Scripture that it's simply going to help us with our lives and our problems, and it does, but it also like calls upon us in these deep ways. It's got some weight and some heft for our lives, and something about us secretly desires it. We want it. Sell all you have, give to the poor, or something like this. Like, it's got moral weight this week, this reading for me. The weight of it is that it tells life as it is. Like, how it really is. By your words, you'll be justified. By your words, you'll be condemned. That's how it really works. I've told Gail Tuttle this before. When she hired me to come be her minister of the university, that she might have mercy upon me, because I taught for a living. But my first boss, when I was right out of college, y'all's age, right, I just kind of thought the world revolved around me. I don't know how I had that mentality, but that's how I thought. I don't know. And he took a lot of pity on me. There, one day, we were having a coming to Jesus moment, and he said, "Preston, your mouth is going to get you in trouble one day." And it got me in trouble. By your words, you will be justified. By your words, you'll be condemned. And Jesus says, out of the abundance of your heart, your words will come forth. Like, what kind of heart you have, what kind of words you have. Like, it's just how it really works in the world. I'd say that was like some of the best advice that person ever gave me. I didn't want to hear it then, but it's taught me again and again and again. The words speak what's in the heart. So true. So sure. I think that we have some kind of problem with this. We think words are meaningless. We say talk is
cheap.
We say sticks and stones will break our bones, but we've got these kind of things. We think that like words, they don't really mean that much. Maybe it's because we're surrounded in chatter all the time. Just sort of surrounded in gossip, our news feeds, our Twitter feeds, our CNNs and MSNBCs and Fox News. It's just chatter all the time. There's talk all the time. And Jesus is wondering, like, where's the really substantive talk? Where's the weight? Where's the stuff that changes lives? Chatter. So much around that. We gotta think, like, talk's cheap. sticks and stones break your bones. But if you've ever been on the end of a comet that cut, it hurt. There's something really substantive to words. They matter. They say what's in the heart. It's chatter. It mattered to Jesus. It mattered in Scripture. Jesus wants us to pay attention to words. And the beauty of words, and the challenge of words, and the heft of words, and the weight of words. This is amazing. The only unpardonable sin, Scripture says, is to speak against the Holy Spirit. You'll struggle with that all week. What does that mean? It's got some heft to it. It's got some struggle to it. It's got some weight to it. Or think about the very beginning in Genesis. It says, God spoke over the waste and brought forth life and light. Speaking has got this amazing part in Scripture. There's something about it that's very connected to the sacred. There's something of very God's presence and being in it. When we speak, it's a gift that gets close to the image of God itself. They're really important to Jesus. To speak, how do we speak? Do we speak with grace, or do we chatter and bring it down? You think about chatter sort of deconstructs things, but to speak well can build people up, grow things in amazing ways. Speak well. Jesus says this, he says that you will be, this is what the fruits are. And I think when we hear that, right, the first thing we think of the fruits was this is about action. This is about deeds. Jesus quite connects this, right? That there's really no difference between real action and words that build. They're one and the same. To speak is actually to rue against silence. Speak is to make something new. It's to bring something into the world. Think about how the beginning of John even begins. And in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. There's something so much of God's presence in this. Even this is backed up in science. This is really interesting. Anthropologists, right? They say that what separates humanity from the rest of the animal kingdom, right, is the ability to create alphabets and language and tell story. It connects us something to God. Actually, your words are the first sacrament. Words that you speak can be heavenly or disastrous. They're so much closer to who God is and what God has for us. We say, what can we do about it? What can words do to change the world? I love how Fred Craddock, he was this amazing preacher, he said, this is the way we typically think of words. We think of words how can a word change the world? It's like trying to break a brick wall with a light bulb. It just shatters against it. And yet, if you've ever been the recipient of a word that just hit you in the right spot, you know how much words can make a difference. One of my jobs is to be with folks in the hospital or in really difficult situations. And I got to tell you, most of the time, I can only find silence. A lot of times we cover ourselves and maybe even chatter in those moments. We say things like, everything happens for a reason. Or we say things like, God needed another angel. But isn't that kind of distances us from another person's pain? Are you with me? A professor of mine said it this way. Her mentor was with her one time in the hospital with a dear friend. And this woman had just gotten disastrous news. And she was at the end of her rope and she said, I don't want to die. And her mentor sat next to her and said, we don't want you to either. It may sound incredibly simplistic, but that woman knows that she's not alone. Those weren't words that distance. Those weren't words that chatter. Those are some holy words. For you do not walk in the darkness alone. Right there with you. Words, they speak to the abundance of what's in the heart, right? These words, they are our first sacrament. This language that we have. We are indeed, though, surrounded by so much chatter. Think about this. Chattering is the lives that we lead and the kind of talk we get. And we so quickly fall in to gossip. And we don't mean to. It just kind of happens. We like drama, and we get into it. I was reading about this week, and I thought this was a wonderful illustration. But gossip, there's this man who comes for confession, and he's in the screen with the priest, and the priest says, gossip, I hear you. And then all of a sudden, the priest gets an idea. He says, we'll say several Hail Marys, but here's what I need you to do right now. This is very urgent, actually. I need you to go to the marketplace and get a hen. And I need this to be a freshly plucked hen. I mean, this hen can have no feathers on it. And so the man's like, really, you need this now? And the man runs out. He goes to the marketplace. And he grabs a hen. And on the way back, he's ripping out feathers from this hen on the way back to the church. And he gets there. He goes, I got one. And the priest says, now go gather up all the feathers. And the man says, that's impossible. They're everywhere. The priest says, yeah, that's gossip. That's the chatter we're in all the time. It just kind of spreads everywhere. But Jesus, he's interested in having some significant language. Some people who are willing to have words that matter, not chatter. Eugene Peterson, he says essentially there's only three words in the world. There's the kind of first kind of word. It's the word you learn when you're a baby, and it's amazing. This morning, before I came here, I did what I do every morning. I picked up my 10-month-old baby, Alexander. I got two twin boys now and a 10-month-old. For those of you who are returning, we have kids. We just keep having kids. I don't know why we have kids. But I picked him up this morning, and picked him out of his crib. And he's like rubbing his eyes, and Alexander, there's a mirror represents his crib, and we looked into the mirror, and he looked at me, and then he just smiled really big, and he buried his head in my shoulder. No words spoken, and so much said. Kids, students, your parents know this language. That's why I just want you to call them from time to time. Words said, so much spoken. It's this language of intimacy. It's this language of trust. And we can say a bunch of words, but are we speaking that? Peterson says there's two other kinds of words that we learn throughout our life. The other, it's information. It's capitals of states. It's names of trees. It's instruction manuals. It's the stuff that shows that you know how to do life. That when you go to a party, you got something to offer. You know a couple of things, right? Like, we're surrounded in the age of information now, right? We got phones that will remember numbers for us, but there's still just so much information. Like, we're gathering all the time. It's kind of got a little bit of dominance. He says the third one, and this is the one that kind of is most dominant today, it's this language of persuasion. It's the language of politics and advertisement that we're always trying to be sold something. And what he says, and I find this so interesting, he says that we've gotten really poor at language one, and really good at language two and three. We're really good at information, and we're really good at persuasion and motivation. But the problem is that it cuts against the grain of who we are, too. They're necessary, but when you get too much of it, you always feel like a product or someone who's trying to be sold something constantly. You lose a bit of that divine image that's within you, you know? Surround ourselves in chatter and not substantive speech. I tell you, like, Jesus wants you to learn this language one. Reading scripture is all about this language one. Students who host chapel each week and they come to pray, they often will ask, well, what do I pray about? And I just say, let it be honest, whatever it is. What is prayer but just an honest talk? Some weight to one's life. Heart's deepest desire, actually. It's our primary language, and we neglect it all the time. Like, to spend a life with Scripture and to spend a life with Jesus is just an ongoing conversation with this companion who wants you to have a deeper language one. It's a language of trust. It's a language of prayer. It's a language of honesty and intimacy. It's what creates a kind of abundance of the heart that you might speak well in this life. The beauty of really good language, too, and you know this, is that it makes new things. And I think about this, we're doing this series on 1 Corinthians these next 4 weeks on Wednesday nights. And it's got that beautiful line at the very beginning, if I speak in the tongues of angels but do not have love, I am a noisy gong, right? There's so many noisy gongs, but like, something about good speech being so connected to God's heart and this image of God is that when one speaks well, it creates something new. one of the coolest things I get to do is to be with High Point University students who meet one another and get married. There are some of you in this room today that will meet one another and get married. I promise you this will happen. And I get to come up here with them. And one of them says, I will. I will. And a whole new thing is made. A whole new family. Or God's first words. Over the darkness swept the water, swept the spirit, and God spoke and said, it is good, and something new is made. Have you ever said sorry to someone and meant it, and a whole bridge was created? Oh man, words that matter. They create something new into the world, something whole and beautiful. I want to close with just this one story, and I shared it. The reason we're doing this morning, I was thinking of this, is that we've been spending time this year thinking about what is good conversation. We had Celeste Headley this week who talked about the power of language and good conversation, and it's always founded on a sense of trust. What is language one but creating a sense of trust that you can have conversations that really matter? I shared this with students, first-year students at the beginning of the year at the Honor Code speech, and it was about an experience I had in fifth grade. And my dad, he's the one who taught it to me. In fifth grade, confession is good for the soul, but bad for the reputation. So hold this for me. But when I was in fifth grade, I got caught cheating on a geography test. And the teacher called my mom, and I went home. My mom wouldn't speak to me. She did say, your father will be home soon. Yeah. And he came home. And he wouldn't speak to me either. He walked by me. And he did something amazing. He grabbed a bowl full of water. Right? He took just a household china, and he wrote something on it, and he filled it with water, and he came back to me and said, Preston, do you see this bowl of water? And I said, yes, sir. I made sure to say, sir. He said, you see what's written on it. And before I could say the word trust, he poured it out on the floor. And he said, and that's how much trust your teachers have in you now. It crumpled me. And yet it taught me so much. And I'll tell you this. This is why it matters. There's no way you would have been able to say that to me and me hear it. There wasn't some language one already spoken. If there wasn't some trust already created, deep and abiding trust. I said that you're odd for coming here this morning. Where do we go in this world to live lives like we're called to be? Where do we go to learn how we're supposed to live? No one goes looking for criticism anymore, but there are places in this world, church and families, chief among them, that have this ability to speak language one that we might be called to be who we're supposed to be. A word from the Lord and the word from our families. Where language one is paramount. The primary language of intimacy and trust. So may out of the abundance of your heart, may you speak well. And may you speak something new into this world. And may it reflect God's great mercy and image into this world. For for our words we shall be judged. We shall be condemned, or we shall be.
Good morning, everyone. If you could please open your hymnals to page 117 and stand and join me in singing, O God, our help in ages past.
come and speak a word of promise and hope and intimacy to you. May he walk with you through this day and through this week, that you know you are not alone. That you may change your heart, that you may change the world around you. Go in the name of the Father and the Son. Amen.